The long and short of this is Arnulfo Teves does not want to be extradited. He wants to stay in Timor-Leste, correct?
Definitely. That's why we are fighting the extradition request of the Philippine government.
What grounds do you believe? Will the government of Timor-Leste, the courts, disagree to an extradition treaty, considering one, the treaty exists. Number two, there are murder charges against Arnulfo Teves. Why won't they extradite him?
First of all, I want to disabuse the minds of the public. Information na naman to ng DOJ, wala pong extradition treaty between the Republic of Timor-Leste and the Republic of the Philippines. However, under international law, in the absence of an extradition treaty, any country may make a extradition request to another country. However, nagiging discretionary po yan. Kasi kung may treaty po, it becomes a treaty obligation to extradite the person. Kapag wala pong treaty, it becomes discretionary. That's why we are now in court to determine it. Now, alam niyo po, based on the historical experience of Timor-Leste, they're very big on human rights. And their constitution states that a person is staying in Timor-Leste, whether he's a citizen or someone who is sojourning or a visitor, cannot be extradited. Number one, if the charges are politically motivated. Number two, if the requesting state is requesting for extradition due to a crime that carries with it the imprisonment at the penalty of life in prison or life imprisonment. Number three, the person cannot be extradited if there is a reasonable ground to believe that there will be threats to his life or he will be treated in a degrading and inhuman manner. So, napakahigpit po ng kanilang konstitusyon kung sinong pwede at kung sinong hindi pwede ang i-extradite.
Okay, now, Attorney Topacio, what makes you think that Arnulfo Teves will fall under that description? Because the qualities you've just described, they can fall for Laila de Lima. But Arnulfo Teves had a private army. He is believed to be the mastermind in the killing of, if I remember correctly, 8 people. The police was under his control in his province. Arms were found in his property. In other words, this doesn't seem to be the profile of a politician who is a political victim. Globally, that would be someone like Laila de Lima, but not Arnulfo Teves. How could you establish that he was or this is politically motivated?
And all of your statements, ma'am, you forgot one essential phrase in our Constitution. A person is presumed innocent until proven otherwise. The DOJ can allege all of these things. He can even allege that he killed Jose Rizal, Magellan, Lapu-Lapu, Gregorio del Pilar. But all of these things are irrelevant when it comes to addition because as of now, as of this very moment, none of these things have been established by a court of competent. And that is precisely when the DOJ and the Philippine government did all of these things, not only goes to prove that, number one, it is politically motivated because the terrorism charge, who determined him to be a terrorist? A group of people all appointed by President Marcos, who in a conversation with this representation the third week of March 2023, specifically said that even that early, without investigation having been terminated by the DOJ, the president was personally convinced that Mr. Teves was guilty. So if the chief executive has already that belief, that all of the actions that came after that will be politically motivated. Number two, it cannot be denied that our laws carry the penalty of life imprisonment for the charges against Mr. Teves, which are multiple murder and terrorism. So it falls under that. Number three, we have a report from the PNP that there are threats to the life of Mr. Teves. Now, this government is trying to hide that report. Unfortunately for the government, the OSG, the Solicitor General, who is a very honorable man, revealed that to the Supreme Court. Now, we are requesting for a copy of that report from General Narutates and Congress, but they are refusing to give us that report. So all of these things, you can see, you can show the political hand behind the persecution of Mr. Teves. And all of these things we will prove before the Timor-Leste court.
Okay, Attorney, my last question on this is, at the end of the day, Arnulfo Teves in Congress was part of the majority. That's number one. And it took the Speaker and President Marcos Jr. some time. They were assuring his security. They were asking him to come home, right? It took a time before he was expelled. In other words, they were asking him to face the charges like any normal Filipino should. And yet, by the time he was alleged to be, let's say, a terrorist or you had said President Marcos Jr. believed in his guilt, that was already many, many months after Arnulfo Teves was a fugitive when he went into
prison. No, it was not many months. Okay. It was a few weeks after the killing. I talked personally to Mr. Marcos in the residence of the Speaker near Malacañang on the third week of March, long before the investigation was terminated. That's why we know that this is politically motivated. It did not take that long. I think from the get-go, Mr. Marcos has been, the mind of Mr. Marcos has been poisoned by people around him to convince him that Mr. Teves is the mastermind behind the Degamo killing long before the termination of the proceedings before the DOJ. But of course, if the chief executive believes you're guilty, what will the Secretary of Justice do? He's under the direct control of the president. So, he's a cabinet member, he's a qualified political agent of the president. He cannot go against the wishes of the president.
Okay, so would it be right to say that it isn't politically motivated, but you believe you will not get a fair trial in the Philippines? Because politically motivated...
Ma'am, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
Ma'am, I'm sorry, you were garbled. Timor-Leste is the world's fourth slowest internet. Could you please repeat the last question?
Okay, based on just what you said, would it be fair to say that it's not politically motivated, but you believe you will not get a fair trial in the Philippines? Because to establish that something has to be politically motivated means you are political opponent somehow. And yet he was not a political opponent of the Marcoses. He was with the majority in Congress.
Correction. He was a political opponent. First of all, he supported the presidential bid of Manny Pacquiao. Number two, he was speaking strongly against the Malika Sovereign Fund. That is a matter of record. Number three, he spoke strongly against the practice of government of forcing the generals to submit their courtesy resignations. On so many issues, he went against the government, and he has never joined the party of the Speaker. He remained with his own party. So that qualifies him as a member of the opposition.
All right. I may not agree with that, but on that note, you are his lawyer. What is the next plan? So you have an extradition hearing. How long will this go on?
Well, we have other witnesses who will testify. My testimony is true. It was done yesterday. Former Human Rights Commissioner Soriano will be testifying today. And so with former Presidential Chief Legal Counsel Salvador Panelo and a few other lawyers. Yesterday also, a victim, one of his staff members was a victim of torture and who formally complained before the Commission on Human Rights, gave her story about how she was being forced to implicate Mr. Teves. That is why we believe we cannot get a fair trial because, you mentioned De Lima. When the witnesses of De Lima recanted, she was granted bail. And that was at at a later stage of the trial. In this case, all 10 witnesses against Mr. Tevez recanted very early on before the preliminary investigation of the DOJ, yet they still filed a under normal circumstances. In experience as a lawyer for 32 years, if witnesses recant before the preliminary investigation, the case is it was not done.
All right. Well, on that note, I think the big difference also is the fact that De Lima, despite her believing that the charges were unfair, she submitted herself to the authorities, attorney. She was in jail for 6 years, considering she was innocent. And yet Arnulfo Tevez, considering he is a lawmaker, became a fugitive. He escaped instead of actually putting himself to a higher standard and submitting himself before the law, when the irony is he's a lawmaker. That's
same thing was done by Panfilo Lacson. He called it a fugitive from injustice. And yet we do not hear that kind of condemnation from anyone after Mr. Lacson was acquitted ultimately by the courts. So different strokes for different folks.
Do you believe that Arnulfo Tevez's case and Panfilo Lacson was the same?
Well, they both claim political persecution. That is the claim of Mr. Lacson. He even made a movie out of it called 10,000 Hours, where he was played by Robin Padilla. So the allegation on the part of Mr. Lacson is clear. He even made a privileged speech pointing to me as his political persecutor under the control of Mrs. Arroyo. So I think that cases are similar. I was also involved in that Lacson case as in this time as a prosecutor, as a counsel for Colonel Mangkaw. So I know the facts very well.
Okay, well, on that note, so how long is the hearing going to go on?
It should end, Ma'am Karen, by the 17th. We have hearings now because it's not a holiday here. So I will still be expected to be in court to lend moral support to Commissioner Soriano and to deal with other motions before the court.
Okay, so if the extradition hearing ends on the 17th, when will the court decide?
I will have to ask my counterparts here in Dili. Dili ko alam eh. Kasi iba po yung procedure nila.
Oo. Because kapag nag-decline, then is there room for appeal for the Philippine government?
Yes. No, well, either way, whoever is not favored in the extradition hearing will have the right to appeal to a higher court. And in the meantime, if it is if the ruling is against us, the extradition is stayed until after the termination of the appeal, just like in the Philippines.
All right, another question is, you are the lawyer of Pastor Apollo Quiboloy.
I'm sorry po, that last one came in garbled also.
Okay, you are the lawyer.
You have to pardon the internet here.
You are the lawyer of Pastor Apollo Quiboloy.
Yes, I'm one of the lawyers po, Ma'am Karen.
Okay, is he still in the Philippines?
Of that, I have no knowledge, Ma'am Karen.
Okay, and I have another question for you as a lawyer. Why do you choose to defend individuals who will not face the court of law? Pastor Apollo Quiboloy is a fugitive as well. He is in hiding. And Arnulfo Tevez, I mean, why are you drawn to these clients?
Well, I'm not drawn to these clients, ma'am. Legal ethics limits from soliciting clients. It appears that they are drawn to me. Akala yata nila magaling ako sapagkat nag-guest ako sa Head Start. Eh, akala lang nila yon.
Pero ang tanong ko, like si Apollo Quiboloy, if you're one of his lawyers, you don't have information if he's still in the Philippines or not?
Ma'am, it's the client who chooses what kind of information he gives us. And ultimately, whether they go into hiding or they face justice, it's their own choice. We try to give them our best advice, but of course, ultimately, it is the client who chooses the path that his case will take. We can only render legal assistance, legal counsel, but we cannot provide personal counsel. That is beyond the scope of our advocacy.
No, but then you talk on the phone, do you? How do you communicate?
I have not communicated with Mr. Kibuloy for some time. Of course, with Mr. Tevez, he is allowed to communicate with his lawyers whenever his counsels visit him. He is allowed to relay information to me in the Philippines through his Timor-Leste counsels. And we regularly exchange notes with my counterparts here in Dili.
All right. My last question is, do you believe Pastor Apollo Kibuloy will remain in hiding until the end of President Marcos Jr.'s term?
Well, I have no information sufficient to form an opinion on that. I think we, at the moment, we shall have to leave the situation as it is. But I think there is a biblical quote to that. I think it is in John. It says, "Hahanapin ninyo ako, ngunit hindi niyo ako matatagpuan."
I don't think that biblical quote belongs to him. This is a man who is accused of trafficking children. That does not belong to him. But on that note, I want to thank you.
Accused, not convicted.
But that does not belong to him. All right? That particular biblical quote. But on that note, thank you very much, Attorney Ferdinand Topacio. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right. We're going to thank you.